Yes. So the topic given to me is the role of yoga in preventive healthcare. It's a very big topic as such. So, but I'll try to be very brief in explaining this topic given to me. So I have given it a subtitle, Role of Yoga in Preventive Healthcare, a Scriptural Basis. Because this topic can be dealt with in many ways. So today I am trying to have a look at the scriptures and the basis in the scriptures, whether yoga can really help us as a preventive tool to maintain our health. So we'll just take a brief review of that. And of course, as I mentioned, it is a vast topic. There are so many facets to this topic. But I'll stick to the scriptural aspect. Not all the scriptures, of course, only some scriptures we'll discuss. And so that is my limitation today of this topic, that I'm going to stick to myself in the scriptural references as far as therapeutic aspects of yoga are concerned, and try to find something whether it is really a preventive healthcare or not. So at the beginning, I'll make a statement that yoga is not a therapeutic science. You all will be perplexed what I'm talking about, because the topic given to me is different, and I'm talking about something different, that yoga is not a therapeutic science. So why I have kept this sentence at the beginning of my presentation, I'll explain to you in brief. Basically, when you are doing research, the modern research methodology, I think probably some of you might be aware of the research methodology, where you start with some kind of hypothesis. Now, this hypothesis can be of two types. One can be a positive statement and one can be a negative statement. So this is that negative statement, that yoga is not a therapeutic science. So I start with this premise that yoga is not therapeutic, and try to examine the scriptures to find out whether this statement is correct or this statement is not correct. Now, if we find that this statement is incorrect, then we can conclude that yoga is definitely a therapeutic science. So this is the way the research is done as far as modern research methods are concerned. Of course, there are many ways of dealing with this topic, of this statement, whether it's true or not. One way, of course, is a review of the literature, review of the research which is happening all over the world for more than 25 years now. Because everywhere in the world, yoga has been examined as therapeutic science using the modern research methodology, where you have some groups and some study groups and control groups, and essentially use statistical methods to examine whether yoga works or any method works on those set of people or not. And then you arrive at conclusion using the statistics, and then you say that whether the statement is correct or not. So this is the routine method, or the most accepted method available today as far as research is concerned. But as far as yoga is concerned, I believe that there are some lacunae as far as this system is concerned. But as we don't have a better system for research, we have to go by that system, because basically yoga is the individualistic science, whether it is teaching yoga or practicing yoga. A lot depends upon how your teacher teaches you, and a lot depends upon how sadhaka responds to the teaching of the teacher. So even though the teacher may be teaching in a particular way, it will have a varied effect on the sadhaka. If there is a group of sadhaka, you cannot predict that every person, there will be the same effect. So that is a limitation when we use modern research methods for therapeutic yoga. But since we don't have better methods, we have to stick to that. So instead of going that way, I would like to examine the textual references or scriptural references. So whether any yoga scriptures have references that yoga can be authentically called as therapeutic science or not. So we are going to take a brief review of some of the scriptures, if not all scriptures, because I am not a very much knowledgeable person to know all the scriptures. I know only a few scriptures on the surface, I would like to say. So we'll just take a quick review to find out whether there is a scriptural base to this statement, whether yoga is a therapeutic science or yoga is a preventive tool for, or is a preventive healthcare. It has got some important place. So we'll take a dip into the scriptural reviews. So first part of my presentation will be the review of the scriptures to find out whether yoga is a therapeutic science or not. And in the second part of my presentation, we will deal with, or rather I discuss whether yoga can be preventive healthcare. So again, that with the reference of some scriptures only, not with the any other references. So these are my limitations of this today's presentation, that we are just going to deal with the scriptures to deal with the topic. And then we'll come out with a few slides containing how yoga can be used in day-to-day life for preventive diseases. So this will be the whole structure of my presentation today. And I'll try my best to give justice to this topic given by Vijayji. So first, let us take a look at what do we mean by therapy. So when we talk about therapeutic science, what do we mean by therapy? In simple terms, therapy is nothing but healing. The very word therapia means healing, the Greek word. And the word therapy derived from that. So in simple terms, therapy is a treatment for diseases. So there can be various aspects of therapy. One is a preventive, other curative, and a third is supportive. Preventive means that, as the title of the topic says, whether a therapeutical method helps us to prevent the diseases. The second aspect is, once a person has got diseases, whether that therapeutic science helps us to cure those diseases. And the third aspect is supportive. If any other method of therapy is given to the particular person, whether yoga or any particular therapy will support that therapy or enhance that therapy. So suppose, for example, somebody is undergoing some kind of surgery using modern medical science, whether homeopathy or Ayurveda medicines will support that treatment so that the progress towards the healing will be faster, or it will be better, the therapy will be better. That is called a support treatment. So these are the three aspects of therapy. And of course, yoga has got, the place for all these three aspects. But today we are going to discuss about the scriptures, as we said. But we need to understand what we mean by therapy and what are the basic different types of therapy. Now, as we said, that aim of any therapy is to attain health, whether it is curative, preventive, or supportive. To attain the health or to maintain the health status is the aim of any kind of therapy, whether it is modern medical science, whether it is any kind of homeopathy, Ayurveda, or any pranic based therapies. All the therapies, the aim is to attain the health or to maintain the health. So health, as far as WHO is concerned, it has defined health as a state of complete physical, mental, and social well-being, and not merely absence of disease or infirmity. I think it is a well-known definition given by WHO about the health, and it covers the different aspects of personality, not only physical disease, it covers mental and social aspects as well. But if we consider the definition given by Sushruta, it is much more deeper than that. It considers prasanna atma indriya manaha. So it also considers the atma, the inside core part, and of course indriya and mana also. So that's why our ancient Indian definition of health is much more deeper as compared with WHO. And that's why the yoga being our ancient science, so we can deduce from this definition that yoga will deal with much more deeper aspects of health rather than the definition provided by WHO. And after all, health is nothing but something called as homeostasis. There is a concept of homeostasis or balance at all levels of personality. This concept is there in the modern science, but in our ancient literature or ancient philosophy, the concept of balance is present for quite a long time. So this swasthya or health is nothing but balance at all the levels. Samodosha samagnisha samadhatu malan. The word sama is there. That means that balance at all the levels is called as health. And that means that we can derive from that if there is some kind of imbalance, then we can call it a disease or infirmity. So it is very simple as far as that is concerned. So imbalance at different levels can be called as disease, and balance at different levels can be called as health. So we'll keep this in mind when we discuss it further. Now, as all of us know, yoga is a science of spiritual elevation. The aim of yoga is samadhi. In fact, Vyasa Muni has defined, or he has, the meaning of word yoga itself is samadhi. Yujja samadho. Vyasa has said yujja samadho. That means that yoga means samadhi. Or as far as Patanjali is concerned, he has given the aim of yoga is the kaivalya, attainment of kaivalya. So that means that yoga is a spiritual method or spiritual sadhana or spiritual science. So again, whether we need to examine whether spirituality or samadhi means going towards health or not, so we'll just find it out. So yoga is a path. Yoga is a path. The path is called as yoga, and our destination, where we want to reach, whether the destination is known to us or is not known to us, still it is called as yoga. So yoga is a path, and we'll examine the path of yoga as far as this health is concerned. Of course, the path is very long, as we can see in this picture. We really cannot see or we cannot perceive the destination, but still we are sure that there is some kind of destination, since this road takes us somewhere. So this is the path of yoga. Now, there are different aspects of yoga or different streams of yoga. As they are well known, one is the Hatha Yoga or Raja Yoga or Patanjali Yoga, Karma Yoga, Bhakti Yoga, and there are many other streams like Mantra Yoga, La Yoga, etc., etc. Now, here we are not talking about these terms, considering the Western, these past few years, there are names, or there were, names given to different kinds of yoga like Hatha, Vinyasa, Ashtanga. So those are the Western concepts, or rather many of them are, not all, but many of them are distorted concepts of yoga. But here we are looking at these terms, Hatha Yoga or Raja Yoga, from the point of view of our own ancient science of yoga, or our own ancient Indian tradition. So it is traditional yoga. These are the terms of traditional yoga. So these are not any patented terms like we find in Western world, or even now in India, we find those patented terms. But that apart, we are talking about our Indian traditional terms called as Hatha Yoga, Raja Yoga, Karma Yoga, and Bhakti Yoga. So we are going to take a brief review of few of the aspects of different streams of yoga to find out about the topic of today, that is the therapeutical aspects. So therapeutics is the methods of doing therapy. Let me explain that. When we say therapeutic, the word therapeutic denotes that it is the method of doing therapy. And therapy, as we have seen, is that it is a method of removal or treating disease or attaining health, the method of attaining health. So therapeutically, we are going to take a look at these strictures. Now we'll start with Hatha Yoga. The purpose of Hatha Yoga, as far as Garinda Sahita is concerned, is Samadhi. Or as far as Hatha Yoga Pradipika is concerned, is called as Nada Anusandhana. So we are just going to refer to two main scriptures of Hatha Yoga, called as Garinda Sahita and Hatha Yoga Pradipika. Hatha Yoga Pradipika has given four angas of yoga, and Garinda Sahita has given seven angas of yoga. And Samadhi is supposed to be last anga of yoga as far as Garinda Sahita is concerned. And basically, Hatha Yoga deals with activation of the hidden or hidden power inside us called as Kundalini power. So it deals with activation of Kundalini power. So one of the aims of Hatha Yoga is activate that Kundalini power, which is lying dormant in each and every one of us. So that means that there is no mention of any kind of therapy here as far as the aim of Hatha Yoga is concerned. So we'll examine it further. Now, Hatha Yoga starts with body. As we are aware that Patanjali Yoga deals with the chitta level sadhana. The Patanjali has given the Yoga Sutra or system of yoga, which deals at the sadhana at the level of chitta. So I don't like to call it as practice. So there are few words which cannot be translated to any other language. Just like the word yoga cannot be translated, similarly, the sadhana word cannot be translated as practice. So conventionally, it is called as practice. but I prefer to call it a sadhana. So Patanjali has given the sadhana at the level of chitta, and in Hatha Yoga, we start the sadhana at the level of body. So body is used as an instrument for reaching the ultimate goal of samadhi or nadana, whatever. So we have to start with body. Now, as we know that the Hatha Yoga tradition, as far as the scriptures are concerned, started from 6th century onwards. It is believed that as ordinary people started practicing yoga, Hatha Yoga was given to them because they have to start, because body is something which we can perceive, we can see. And that's why for common people, it was easier to start with the body level sadhana rather than the chitta level sadhana propounded by Muni Patanjali. And it is believed that since in the modern times, the common people started practicing or doing yoga sadhana. Earlier times, probably only munis and rishis were doing the yoga sadhana. So this practice of Hatha Yoga started. Of course, the Hatha Yoga practice is not indicated only for the body. It is indicated, as we have discussed earlier, for the activation of the Kundalini power. But we have to start with the body. So the aim of Hatha Yoga is to make the body clean. So cleanse the body of all the impurities, make it flexible. As far as the scriptures are concerned, it is reference is given that body becomes flexible, it becomes supple, it becomes fit, it becomes steady, it becomes healthy, and it becomes strong. So with asanas, as we can see the slokas in the Hatha Yoga scriptures, we'll find that puryatadasam sthairam arogyam cha angalaghavam. That means that arogya word is mentioned. That means that health is mentioned. So by doing asana in a hatha yogic way, we can attain the health. It has been mentioned there. And especially Garuda Sahita propounds the term called as ghata shuddhi. So here, body is like a ghata or earthen pot. As we know that earthen pot, when we make the earthen pot, and if it is dipped in the water, it is going to disintegrate unless we make it strong. So when we heat the earthen pot, it becomes strong. And it can hold the water also. Not only it will not disintegrate, it can hold the water also. So similarly, the body has to be made strong by removing the impurities from that. So yoga is nothing but science of purification, whether it is at the physical level, mental level, or chitta level, at different levels. Yoga is nothing but the science of purification. Even Patanjali has given the reference of that, as we will see that when we come to that. So as far as Hatha Yoga is considered, it makes the body strong and fit for the further sadhana of activation of Kundalini. Of course, the purpose is going towards Raja Yoga or Samadhi, but for that, we have to make the body fit for that. So even though Hatha Yoga starts with the body or talks about Ghata, but mind also is the facet of that Ghata. So it works on mind also. We must bear in mind that Hatha Yoga not only works on the body, it works on the mind as well. And overall speaking, there are various aspects or various angles of Hatha Yoga. I am not going scripture wise, but I am going overall, I am taking overall review of the scripture. So, Chatkriyas or purification practice, Shuddhi Kriyas, Asana, Pranayama, Mudra, Dharana, etc. and Nada Anusandhana, these are the various sadhanas given by Hatha Yoga scriptures. The purpose of Hatha Yoga, as we have said, is that bringing perfection into our being, and body is one part of that. Body is important part of our being. So as we know as yoga sadhakas, that we are not only body, but we are much more than our body, which is seen and perceived. So one of the aspects of Hatha Yoga is to make the body beautiful, graceful, strong, and harness. And I quote not from any yogic scriptures. This shloka is from Uttarama Charitam. And I remember Dr. Nagendra Guruji quoting this shloka many times during his different lectures. Vajradapi Kathorani, Mrududi Kusumadapi. So we should be able to make our body hard whenever required, like a vajra. And we should be able to make it soft also whenever it is required, soft like a flower. So there is a perfection at body level. So that doesn't mean that, as we have seen that with weightlifting and all the training methods, now we find that all the six packs and other things are popular, that building up of muscle power. So make the body very hard. So in yoga, it's not only that, but it's up to one's own, you know, ability to make it hard or make it soft as per the requirement of that particular time. And that is the beauty of Hatha Yoga. And even though this slogan is not from Hatha Yoga, so it fits to the concept of Hatha Yoga, to the ideal body. And there is a reference of Kaya Sampat in Patanjali Yoga Sutra, that when you attain perfection in yoga, you get supernatural powers. And one of the powers is Kaya Sampat, that is a perfect body. So that means that even Patanjali has considered body as in one of the aspects of the being, and that's why he has mentioned the word as Kaya Sampat. So in short, we can say the Hatha Yoga, with the sadhana of Hatha Yoga, the mind becomes strengthened, the intellect is sharpened, and intuition is developed because of Hatha Yoga. These are the three attainments of the practice of yoga, not only Hatha Yoga, but any kind of yoga. Now, the science of perfection in Hatha Yoga are mentioned in one of the slokas in Hatha Yoga Pradipika. It's a very famous sloka, Vapu Purushottamam Vadane Prasannata Nada Sputatvam Nayane Sunirmale Arogata Bindu Javayogni Deepanam Nadi Vishuddhi Hatha Siddhi Lakshanam. That means that these are the symptoms of the perfection of Hatha Yoga. So that means that a lean body, cheerful face, clear voice, bright eyes, freedom from illness, control over urges, and clean nadis. So when we look at the person, we come to know whether he is healthy or not, or whether he is a yoga sadhak or not. So immediately after looking at the person, after conversing with the person, we come to know whether the person is a yoga sadhak or not, merely by looking at it, by following these symptoms which are given in Hatha Yoga Pradipika. So these are the symptoms of perfection in Hatha Yoga, and you will find that freedom from illness is one of the aspects of that. And of course, cheerful face and lean body, of course, are aspects of being healthy. Then there is a reference that Hatha Yoga Pradipika says that if you are affected by tapa or miseries of life, ashesha tapa tapta nam, that means that if you are affected with miseries of life, the Hatha Yoga is like a mutha for us. It is like an ashram. It is like a mutha for us. Who will give? The Hatha Yoga will give relief from the tapa which we experience in our day-to-day life. So we are going to examine what do we mean by tapa also later on during this presentation. But if you are afflicted with miseries of life, then you come to Hatha Yoga. So that will give relief from that. Then who can practice Hatha Yoga? Yuva vruddho ti vruddho va vyadhito durbulo pi va. That means that young, of course, can practice Hatha Yoga. But not only that, the old and very old people, and even the people affected with different ailments or weak people also can practice or also can do sadhana of Hatha Yoga. That means that Hatha Yoga deals with vyadhis or diseases also. One more reference we find that diseases is mentioned in Hatha Yoga, so that even all these people can have abhyasa. The word abhyasa is mentioned along sadhana of yoga, and we can attain siddhis. Siddhis, that means that we can overcome all those difficulties in the day-to-day life by sadhana or abhyasa of Hatha Yoga, which is mentioned here very clearly. So that means that yoga is an effective tool. Hatha Yoga is an effective tool in dealing with all these problems of old age or diseases or weakness also, or even in the problems of young age. Now we'll examine each aspect of Hatha Yoga, whether it has got any therapeutic base or not. So when we examine the scriptures, many of you might be aware of that, we find a lot of references of different diseases, especially in the Hatha Yoga scriptures, Garanda Sahita and Hatha Yoga Pradipika. We must remember one more thing, that in Hatha Yoga scriptures, many times tall claims are made. So probably those claims are made to attract people. We are really not sure about that. But we must bear in mind that some tall claims have been made in Hatha Yoga scriptures. Of course, they must be having some basis for that. But we should not take them literally. So we have to examine them very clearly, all those various references. So we should not take them literally as per the words, as we'll discuss about it later on. So Shatkriya deals with purification or removing of the impurities. And the shloka says, Shatkarma nirgatam stavlyam kafadosha maradikaha. So if there are excess, kapha dosha or mala is in excess, and sthaulya is removed by the sadhana of chat karma. So chat karma not only purifies the body, it purifies the nadis as well, as per the references given in the Hatha Yoga Pradipika. And then each and every Shuddhi Kriya references, there are numerous references towards the diseases as far as Hatha Yoga is concerned. I hope I am audible.
Yeah, you are audible, okay, but yeah, I will request to one person, Kuldeep. Who is Kuldeep?
Yeah, I think there's some disturbance.
Haan, please Kuldeep, आपका म्यूट करो, जो भी ऑडियो है वो म्यूट करो, ठीक है?
ओके, सो सो ईच एंड एवरी साधना इन हठ योग स्क्रिप्चर्स विल फाइंड रेफरेंसेस मेड टुवर्ड डिसीजेस. सो वी आर टेकिंग अ स्टेप बाय स्टेप रिव्यू ऑफ थेरेप्यूटिक एस्पेक्ट्स ऑफ योग एज फार एज हठ योग इज कंसर्न. सो ईच एंड एवरी क्रिया specific benefits are given in the scriptures. Vatasara dhoti sarva rog kshayo bhavet, removal of all the diseases. Again, we should not take it literally, but that means that vatasara dhoti is effective for treating different kind of diseases, or rather a variety of diseases. Now varisara dhoti agnisara and prakshalana, the reference is body like God, deva deham prapadyate. What do we mean by body like God or deva deham? That is mean we are not going to become gods by practicing these, but our body will become perfect because the gods are supposed to have perfect body. So our body will become perfect after these practicing these Shuddhi Kriyas. Of course, we need to remember when we take these references that it is not a one-time practice or one-time sadhana of these Kriyas or any kind of sadhana. We need a long time, you know, as references given in the earlier sloka which we have seen. Abhyasa by its very nature is a long time practice, is not a one time practice. So we must remember that when we say that a particular kind of Shuddhi Kriya we get particular attainments, so we must remember that those we can get only after practice of for long time. Then Jivadhoti, then Jaramarana Nashanam is a common term used in Hatha Yoga at many places. That means that we can conquer old age and death, but in reality we can postpone the death, but we cannot conquer the death, because the very fact that those rishis who have written these sentences, they are no longer, or they are not longer bodily present in this world. But the meaning, as I said, we should not take it literally. So we make our old age pleasurable when we practice these. So, and we can prolong the death, or we can prolong the life. So we can take this meaning of Jaramarana Nashanam this way. Then Jivadhoti works on different diseases and kapha dosha. Danda Dhauti deals with the diseases related to area around the heart. This is the mention in the scriptures. Vastra Dhauti deals with abdominal diseases, fever, enlarged spleen. So we must note this peculiar thing in Hatha Yoga scriptures. Enlarged spleen or spleen is mentioned at many places. Now we wonder how those rishis thousands of years back knew about the different organs in the body, because they must not have done any kind of dissection which we do in the modern science. So they were aware by intuition. And spleen is one organ of the body which is responsible for the immune response of the body. The immunity of the body depends upon the spleen also. The spleen is one of the organs which participates in the immune response of the body. So it's very peculiar that I find that spleen is mentioned at many places. That means that it must be dealing with immunity. All these aspects must be dealing with immunity. And immunity, as we know, is the preventive aspect of our body. If our immunity is strong, it will prevent the diseases inflicting our body. So that's my, it is a preventive nature, and spleen is mentioned at many places. So abdominal diseases, fever, and kapha pitta disease, asthma also. Mulashodhan deals with constipation, indigestion, etc. It stimulates the gastric fire. Jalabasti deals with urinary diseases, digestive disorders, and one becomes free from disease. Again, Kamadeva. Kamadeva is the god of love, but we should take the meaning as the perfection as far as the body is concerned, physical perfection. So that is the meaning of, we can take it as the meaning of Kamadeva. Neti deals with Kapha Dosha again. It deals with Drushti Dosha or vision. And it deals with the diseases of the region above the neck. Navli is responsible for dealing with all the diseases, especially kindling of gastric fire. Trataka deals with diseases of eyes. These are all references given in the scriptures. I'm not talking from my own mind, you know, or somewhere else. But these are hard facts which are mentioned in the scriptures. Kapalabhati deals with Kapha Dosha. And again, Chitkram Kapalabhati, again, Kamadeva is mentioned. You may be slightly bored by all these lists, but I think we need to go into that to understand the importance of that. Asana leads to firmness of body. Asanam bhavet drudam. The steadiness, health, and dualities are reduced as far as Patanjali is concerned. Then Sihasana and Matsyasana. Then again, Hatha Yoga mentioned individual benefits of asanas. So the fitness of firmness of body, steadiness, health, these are the common attainments of the asana. But there are particular attainments given with different asanas. Mayurasana, one can digest poison. That means that our digestive power increases to a great extent. That doesn't mean that we should have poison that will not have bad effects, but we'll get ability to digest, our digestive system improves. Then it deals with all three doshas. Excess food can be digested, and even the deadly poison can be digested. This is a tall claim made by the Hatha Yoga Sutras, but that means that digestive power can be increased by practice of Mayurasana. Paschimottanasana leads to, again, gastric fire, obesity, all the diseases. Shavasana removes fatigue and it gives rest to Chitta. Here the word Chitta is mentioned in Hatha Yoga also. So Hatha Yoga also has got sadhana at the level of Chitta. And with Siddhasana, all the nadis are cleansed so that the middle channel or Sushumna opens up. Padmasana is the destroyer of all the diseases. And mudras lead to steadiness, happiness, conquers old age. Again, Jaramana Nasharam. And it is peculiarly mentioned here against spleen and leprosy, but 21 types of diseases can be cured by the use of mudras. So they are not mentioned which are those 21 types, but 21 types of diseases. That means that multiple diseases can be cured by the long practice of mudra. Mahamudra deals with fever, spleen, digestion, and Uddiyana, Mrityu Matanga Kesari, again, it overcomes death. Jalandhar Bandha and Mahamudra again destroys death. So all these Jaramana Nashanam things are there. So we should take it as we can have pleasure in the old age also, because as we see today that the longevity has improved in modern times, and there are a lot of problems coming up because of old age. And probably if we take this meaning of the Jaramana Nashanam, all these aspects, then these mudras and other yoga sadhana in Hatha Yoga will help us to deal with old age in a better way. Kechari Mudra, of course, deals with different kinds of hunger and thirst, and again, body like God, and there will be no disease, no death. Viparitakarni Mudra again deals with decay and death. Tadagi Mudra again, Jaramana Nasham. Jalandhar Bandha, destroyed of especially throat diseases. Pranayama removes the impurities of Sushumna, and it leads to lightness and removes Sarva Roga Kshayo Bhavet. So proper practice of pranayama will remove all the diseases. And we'll see why pranayama especially deals with the removal of diseases when we discuss yoga assisted concept. And body becomes young, like 16 years old. Surya Bedan Pranayama, Ujjayi Pranayama, so all those mention of different diseases are given in the pranayama also. Again, Sitkari, body becomes like Kamadeva. And again, spleen is mentioned in Sitali, gastric power in Bastrika. And these are the Garana Sahita, Pratyah, Dharana, Dhyana, and Samadhi. So, Pratyah leads to strength and control over sense organs. And Dharana leads to concentration. And of course, Dhyana and Samadhi are spiritual aspects of yoga, even Hatha Yoga. Yoga Nidra is not mentioned in Hatha Yoga scriptures, but that also is found to be beneficial. So, I have added this item of Yoga Nidra here. So, in short, after going through all the scriptures, we can safely decide that Hatha Yoga is definitely a therapeutic science. Even though the goal of Hatha Yoga is not therapy, as we have seen, the Shakti Jagran or activation of Kundalini, and through Shakti Jagran, attaining of samadhi is the aim of Hatha Yoga, but still Hatha Yoga definitely has got numerous references towards dealing with diseases, whether it is a cure or whether it is a prevention. So they are not clearly mentioned that is prevention or cure, but through the tradition and through the experience of various gurus and yogis, we can definitely say that scripturally also Hatha Yoga is a therapeutic science. So many times we are not we never firmly say that yoga is therapeutic science. So we feel that is something we find something less when we call yoga therapeutic science. So we say no, yoga is not therapeutic. Yoga is only a spiritual science, or it is a science which helps us attain samadhi and all those things. So we have this attitude. Many of the yoga practitioners have got the attitude that therapeutic aspect is secondary aspect, and reluctantly we go or we look at yoga as therapy, because as a yoga teacher, all of us are aware, those who are yoga teachers, that people seek or people come to us for learning yoga mostly for overcoming their diseases. I have not come across a sadhaka who has joined a yoga class for attaining with the goal of samadhi. Nobody says that I want to join your diploma course because I want to attain samadhi. So if somebody says that, of course we will not give him admission, because we are not those people who can help somebody to attain samadhi. So most of the people look at the yoga as a therapeutical science, whether we like it or not. Sometimes the traditional yogis may not like this, but since the scriptures mention that, so we should be very confident when we say that yoga is therapeutic science, and it is not only a side effect of yoga. Even though it is a side effect of path, when we go on the path of yoga towards the goal, our goal may not be to attain samadhi. But definitely, whenever somebody starts doing so yoga sadhana, definitely he goes towards attaining samadhi, whether one wants it or not, or whether one is aware about samadhi or not. The very fact that we start yoga sadhana means that we have started walking on the path of that, going towards samadhi. But for all of us, that attainment while going on that path or following that path is very, very important for dealing with day-to-day miseries in life. And that's why we should confidently say that yoga has got the component of therapy definitely, as far as mentioned in the Hatha Yoga scriptures. So that's why at the beginning when we made a statement that yoga is not a therapeutic science, now we have examined only a few references of Hatha Yoga scriptures, and we have found numerous references towards the use of different kind of yoga sadhanas as a therapy, whether it is preventive or curative. So we can be confident that yoga is a therapeutic science, and that's why this Ayush has come up with this yoga therapy module. Definitely, I'm sure about it, because there are very much knowledgeable people sitting there at Ayush who have designed this. So, but still, I thought that I would take a review again and bring confidence that yoga is a therapeutic science. So we should look at yoga as one of the aspects of therapy. And not only us, but even slowly in the past few years, the modern medical science also is looking up at yoga as providing some remedies for some diseases. So as mentioned earlier, I'll just make one reference. So we are not referring to the research which has happened throughout the world about the therapeutic aspects of yoga, because research can happen in yoga only on therapeutic aspects. Research is very difficult to have research on the spiritual aspects of yoga, because there are no parameters which we can help, or mathematically we can derive whether somebody really gets samadhi after practicing yoga or not, somebody really gets kavali or not. We have no way of doing research on that. The only research we can do is mainly on the physical aspects, and of course some mental and emotional aspects. So it is accepted aspect today, because many other doctors, for example, if you take a review of back pain, if you take a review on the internet about back pain, many of the recent research says that yoga is one of the important aspects or one of the important tools of tackling back pain. So if you one has got back pain, one should go towards yoga rather than going towards any medical doctor. Of course, unless there are some big structural problems. But the research points now at different diseases that yoga may be the first line of action as far as treating or managing some diseases are concerned. So we are going towards that. So, but even the scripturally, we have found that yoga is the therapeutic, yoga has spirit therapeutic aspect. Not only the research has proven, but the scriptures also has given that. One more ancient scripture is Yoga Vasishta. Of course, it has dealt with diseases. So it is also, the name yoga is present in that name of that scripture. That means that it deals with yoga. And Vasishta Muni has gone very much deep as far as the diseases are concerned. He has defined two types of causes of pain or miseries. One is the Adhi, one is the Vyadhi. And Vyadhi can be either Adhija Vyadhi or Anarjaya Vyadhi. We are not going to the depth of that. Probably those who are attending the course on therapy will have this much more in depth, much covered, much more in depth. But it is just a passing reference I want to make to Yoga Vasishtha, that again, Vyadhi, Adhija Vyadhi can be of two types, Sara and Samanya. And now Vasishtha has given remedies for these Vyadhis. So I want to deal with that. I'm not going to do what is Vyadhi and what is Adhija Vyadhi, but Vasishtha has given the remedies. As we'll see that. The cause of Sara Vyadhi is rebirth. We all of us must have known about Karma Siddhanta. And the remedy is the spiritual knowledge. Again, the yoga is a spiritual science. So yoga has got a part to play as far as Sara Adhija Vyadhi are concerned. Samanya Vyadhis, Vasishtha has clearly mentioned yoga as a remedy. Yoga is a remedy. That means that Vasishtha has clearly pointed, because as we know, that majority of the diseases are fall into this category of Samanya Vyadhis. Samanya Adhija Vyadhis are much more in numbers as compared to Sara Vyadhis. So even the modern science says that the psychosomatic diseases are much more, maybe more than 80% of all the diseases. So that's why Samanya Vyadhis, and Muni Vasishtha has clearly given the remedy as yoga. So that means that yoga is considered as a remedy for treating the Samanya Vyadhis. So we can conclude that from Yoga Vasishtha also. And even in Anadija Vyadhis, the cause is accidents or you know, other things where yoga may not be helped. That's what we think. But here again, mantra and medicine. Of course, medicine is not part of yoga, but mantra, of course, is a part of yoga. So mantra is a remedy which is part and parcel of yoga. So we can conclude, even by looking at Yoga Vasishtha, that yoga has got a great role to play as far as therapy is concerned. So now we'll go to the main topic wherein we are going to examine the concepts in Patanjali Yoga Sutra. Because we feel that Patanjali does not refer to such kind of, you know, diseases which have been dealt at great length in Hatha Yoga scriptures. But there are nevertheless some references which clearly indicate the disease part also. Even though the Yoga Sutra is for attaining Kaivalya and all the Chitta level sadhanas are given by Patanjali, and Patanjali has gone in great depth about the Chitta of the person. So we'll come to the basic origin of diseases. So as far as not on Sankhya, but many of our India scriptures believe that there are three causes of misery. So this is called a Tapatraya. Tapatraya is the word for that. So there are, when we say Tapatraya, that means that those are not miseries, those are causes of miseries. Why we experience misery in life? These are the three causes of miseries. One is called Adhibhautika, that is caused by the other beings. That means that extra organic, not because of our own self, but it may be due to natural calamities like earthquake or extra rain, you know, things like that, or that is caused by other beings, whether living or non-living beings. That is called Adhibhautika, cause of misery. Adhidaivika is due to fate, or it is due to natural elements, or it may be due to accident, diseases, death in the family, etc. And Adhyatmika is because of one's own inner problems, one's own inner problems in the body and mind. So these are the three causes of misery. And basic cause of these miseries as far as Sankhya is concerned is the because the universe exists because of coming together of Purusha and Prakriti. Once the Purusha and Prakriti come together, the Prakriti starts manifesting, and then once the Prakriti starts manifesting, then these Tapatrayas come into picture. So in manifested Prakriti, there are going to be these Tapatrayas. So that means that our body is a manifestation of this coming together of Purusha and Prakriti, and Prakriti has evolved and is manifested, and that's why our body is created. So that means that we can deduce from this that so long as our body exists, there are going to be this Tapatraya. We have to face this Tapatraya. We cannot escape from this Tapatraya so long as our body exists. So we must remember that this acceptance of this causes of misery has to be there in our mind to tackle the manifestation of this Tapatraya. So Tapatraya are the causes, and Sankhya deals with cause and effect. So every effect has got cause, or effect is built into the cause. That is the basic premise of Sankhya philosophy. So the world or universe is not manifested by chance as far as Sankhya is concerned. There is a definite cause and effect behind that, logical cause and effect behind that. And once the Prakriti has manifested, these miseries are going to be there. The only thing we can discuss is how to overcome these miseries or how to tackle these miseries. But these miseries are going to be there because these miseries are basically because of evolution of universe, because of coming together of Prakriti and Purusha. These are the basic premises which we must remember when we talk about the therapeutic aspect or preventive aspects of yoga. Now, Patanjali has given antaraya, nine antaraya, that means that impediments on the path of yoga. So if you have got these impediments or these conditions, then you may not be able to progress further on the path of kaivalya or path of samadhi. And those start with vyadhi. And I for one believe that this vyadhi mentioned by Patanjali is the adhija vyadhi as given by Muni Vasishtha. So he must be mentioning about adhija vyadhi when he talked about vyadhi. Vyadhi sthana, actually all these sthana samshaya pramada alasya virti bhanti darshana alabdha bhumikatva anasti tatvani, all these chitta vikshepa or impediments are nothing but the signs and symptoms of disease, whether it is at physical level or whether it is at mental level. So if you have got these, then that will prevent the further progress on the path of yoga. And we'll find that because most of the common people have got these nine aspects of antaraya present in us, whether to greater extent or lesser extent, but these are present in most of the people around us. And that's why it is much more relevant, Patanjali is so much relevant to day-to-day life also, even though main of Patanjali is spiritual aspect, but still many of the concepts of Patanjali are very much applicable and useful for day-to-day life as well. And he has mentioned the symptoms of these antaraya. The dukkha daurmanasya angamaya jayato shvasa prashvasa. You will find that misery or the weakness or the angamaya jayato shvasa prashvasa, difficulty in breathing, all these are symptoms of some kind of diseases. So when we take medical help, we have many of these conditions present in us that I am suffering because of pain or suffering because of weakness, suffering because of unsteadiness, angamaya jayato, or I am not able to breathe properly. So these are the symptoms of diseases. If you analyze them, these are symptoms of various diseases. And those are the symptoms of this antaraya or nine impediments given by Patanjali. And of course, Patanjali also gives solution. He doesn't stop at giving the impediments, but there is a solution to it also. So we'll talk about kleshas first, and then we'll talk about a solution given by Patanjali. The five kleshas or pancha klesha are the source of pain or misery in life. The basic source of misery in life is because of klesha. And kleshas are there in everybody. Klesha, afflictions, avidya, asmita, raga, dvesha, abhinivesha is present in each and every one of us. It may be greater extent or lesser extent, because he has given prasuptatana vichinna udara. There are four ways that kleshas can get manifested. So all of us have got kleshas, or for that matter, so long as the body exists, the kleshas are going to be there. Maybe in the attenuated form, the kleshas are always present till we attain the final goal of kaivalya. As far as Patanjali is concerned, klesha nivrutti comes after dharma mega samadhi, just for reference. So kleshas are always there. They may be in a reduced form, but kleshas are there. That means that the kleshas are supposed to be the root source of all the pain in our life. So that means that whatever we do, the kleshas are going to remain with us. And only way we can deal with klesha is to make them less, or reduce them, or attenuate them, make them tanu. That is the only thing which common man can do. And that is the achievement by itself here. If you are able to make the kleshas tanu, it is a great achievement. And that will lead to, you know, a lot of pleasure in life if we are able to do that. So ultimately, the aim, or when we follow Patanjali Yoga, we deal with reducing the kleshas in life. And that will go a long way in reducing the miseries and reducing diseases. So kleshas are the root cause of pain in the life. And it has been mentioned that tasya hetu avidya. As we have seen that, there is a clear cause and effect logic in the Sankhya and Yoga tradition. So there is a hetu, there is a cause, definite cause. So why there is a misery or pain? That is because of avidya. Avidya is the root klesha. Because of avidya, all the kleshas have arisen. The avidya is the root cause of all those other four kleshas. And you will find that asmita, raga, dvesha, abhinivesha, when we examine that, we need to examine that in the context of diseases. Abhinivesha is clinging to life, or our inbuilt intuition, or inbuilt, you know, attitude that we want to preserve our life, we don't want to die. And even the Patanjali has said that even with the elevated people, abhinivesha klesha is present. Even in the elevated people, even those who are practicing yoga for a long time, still abhinivesha klesha is present in them, the fear of death. And raga dvesha, excess attachment and excess aversion, have arisen because of abhinivesha and asmita. We consider as body as the self, and we consider body as permanent, and because of that, all those raga and dvesha, or attachment or aversions, have arisen. And you will find that raga and dvesha are root cause of many of the diseases. As we say, Muni Vasishtha says that the cause of many of the diseases is the mind. And is in the mind because of excessive attachment and excessive aversion. And there is raga dvesha is because of asmita and abhinivesha klesha, root cause is avidya. And Patanjali has further mentioned, we'll go into a slightly difficult part of Patanjali Yoga Sutra, klesha moolah karmashayo drushtadrushta janma vedaniya. That means that whatever is there, the samskaras are there in our karmashaya, we have to bear those samskara in the life. So whether it's good or bad, that means that the klesha is the root cause, but because we have done karmas, or we have been doing karmas in our present life and past life, we have to experience pleasures and pain in life. So that means that philosophically speaking, or scripturally speaking, pain and pleasure, or misery and pleasure, it part and parcel of our life. Only thing which we can do something about is to reduce the miseries. And yoga helps us in reducing the miseries, as far as scriptural references there in Patanjali Yoga also. And that's why he has said that sati mule tat vipako jati ayuvim boga. So what kind of life we are living today is because of our past actions, our past lives. That is the mention given by Patanjali. Of course, that there is a remedy for that. Not only we have to experience the effects of our good and bad karmas, but we can definitely do something, do some sadhana to overcome these kind of effects of this karma. Because there is always a discussion about the nature and nurture. In the psychology also, there is nature and nurture. Something which is natural, or we can change that. So we can definitely change that course of action of the past karmas by doing sadhana. It's not that it only depends upon our past karmas, but we can definitely do something, do some sadhana to overcome them. And that is the basis of the preventive prevention of disorders as far as yoga is concerned. And further, he has mentioned that experience of pleasure and pain are according to the karmas in past and present life. And also, yoga believes in the philosophy similar to Buddha philosophy, that the world is full of miseries, because ultimately everything is misery. And that means that yoga, some people consider this as a pessimistic attitude. It is not pessimistic, because yoga has given the remedy also. Not only yoga says that life is full of misery, but there is a remedy to deal with that misery. That is very important. And that is again the basis we can take as basis of dealing with diseases. So, lak paritapa phala punya apunya hetutva. That means that if we are doing, we have done some punya or apunya, definitely we have to experience that in some life, whether this life or next life. So, this solves the riddle that we, day-to-day life, we come across people who have got more experiences of pleasure than pain. Some people have got more misery than pleasure. But each and every person has got some pleasure and misery. No, there is no person who has got 100% misery or 100% pleasure. So we must remember that. And then there are ways and means of reducing that miseries also. So we must remember that, as given by Patanjali also. So Patanjali has given here that heyam dukkham anagatam. That means that there are means of removal of the miseries which are likely to occur in future also. The miseries are likely to be encountered in future because of our past karmas. And as we have seen that, the karmas may not be foolproof, because there is a way and means of dealing with these karmas or actions of the past. And that's why heyam dukkham. Heyam means that the misery can be abolished. Misery can be, heyam means that it has to be, or it can be abolished. And the miseries, we may not be able to abolish the miseries of the earlier life, but we can avoid the miseries or abolish the miseries which are coming in the future. And the means of doing that is dhyana heya tat luttaya. He has given the method of dealing with those miseries or removal of those miseries in the dhyana. So that means that it boils down that when we consider therapeutic aspect of yoga, dhyana is one of the important tools. And many times we come across that it is missed by many of the yoga therapists. We just deal with asana and pranayama as far as therapy is concerned. But if we want long-term result, of course, asana and pranayama are important tools of moving towards dhyana. So even though Patanjali has given dhyana as the method of removal of those miseries, but in order to go towards dhyana, there is a need to have sadhana of asana and pranayama. And once we have got perfection in that, then only we can go towards dhyana. But we must remember all the time that dhyana, I don't like to translate the word dhyana as meditation, because dhyana is a technical term and it should be translated to all the languages as dhyana only, not meditation or something like that. So dhyana is dhyana. So again, there is a component of dhyana even in the asana also. Patanjali talks about ananda samapatti. So that is the element of dhyana present in the process of asana also. Even for a moment, momentarily, even if you are able to get ananda samapatti, that momentary dhyana actually is helping you to overcome the miseries, you know. And that's why you will see that when we talk about the prevention as far as diseases are concerning yoga, there are no specific, asanas given for dealing with a particular disease. It is the overall effect, because Hatha Yoga has said that even the vyadhito durbulo piva, those who are affected with diseases and weak people also can practice yoga. That means that clearly they will not be able to practice the difficult asanas. But even with simplified yoga practices, one can achieve that. And that is because one has to progress towards dhyana. So doing simple, difficult asanas is not the aim of yoga therapy. It may be good for your body, and some people may be able to practice that, and it is really good. But as far as therapeutic aspects are concerned, difficult asanas are not so important. Practicing the asanas with the principle given by Patanjali is important, because dhyana heya tat vrittaya. And that's why we must understand these conceptual aspects of therapy, when we talk about actual ground level therapy, that's why we are talking about that. It may be slightly boring for you, but we need to understand this basic philosophy of yoga therapy, and then only we can turn into our practical aspects. And then there is something called a Dheya Hetu. That means that there is a definite cause. And what is that cause? Coming together of that Purusha and Prakriti is the cause of that. So that means that the miseries in the life will not be abolished 100% so long as the life exists. So long as we attain the samadhi, all the miseries will not get abolished. So we must remember that. So misery is part and parcel of our life. That's why it has been said that dukkhameva cha vivekinaha. So those elevated people, they know that life is full of misery, but there are definitely ways and means of reducing that misery. And we can live our life well, reducing the miseries, but that doesn't mean that there are not going to be any miseries when we are doing yoga sadhana. So again, day to day, we experience that many times. For example, sometime I had some common cold, you know, and one friend called me and he said, "Are you are a yoga sadhak, you are doing yoga, you are teaching yoga to others, and still you also get cold." So that means that people have got wrong perception that yoga sadhak will never have disease. It's not correct. Yoga sadhak, I'm not going to the research part, but yoga sadhaka, one who is a sadhaka of yoga for a long time, it has been found in day-to-day life that he will be less prone to catching of such common diseases. Doesn't mean that he will not get diseases. If at all he will get those diseases, they will be of milder nature, or he will get cure earlier as compared to other people. That has been observed in yoga sadhakas, because since their kleshas are slightly reduced, since they have got common of dhyana, and that's why the miseries in life are reduced as far as yoga sadhaka is concerned, but they will not be abolished completely. So one part of the therapy is acceptance of disease. When we say the counseling aspect of yoga therapy, the acceptance of disease has to be there, and we have to understand that disease or misery is part and parcel of our life, and we can definitely work towards reduction of that, but doesn't mean that we are not going to be miserable even though we are doing yoga sadhana. There are going to be miseries on our part, but they will be to the lesser extent if you are over a there on the long period of time on the path of yoga. So he has given, Patanjali has given the Hanopaya also, the means of removal of those miseries. Viveka khyati aviplavaha. That means that you have to maintain that viveka khyati which you attain when you move towards samadhi. That is spiritual concept. Of course, we will not discuss that in great details. But only thing is, we have to keep in mind that our inner self or the consciousness principle and body is different. And if we keep that in mind, then that is one of the methods of or means of attaining that reduction of misery. I will not say removal of miseries, because for common people is concerned, we can just talk about reduction of miseries. And then Ashtanga Yoga, he has mentioned that Yoganga Anusthana Ashuddhi Kshaye. That means that removal of impurities. As I mentioned in the beginning, yoga is a science of removal of impurities, a science of purification at different levels. So impurities from chitta are removed because of practice of Ashtanga Yoga. And Ashtanga Yoga is a means of removal of those impurities, are going towards the balanced state. So in the later part of my presentation, I'll just briefly touch upon these important principles given by Patanjali to deal with miseries of life. And many times it is ignored, this sadhana is ignored by many people. So vitarka badhane pratipaksha bhavanam, the important sadhana given by Patanjali, because we know that, of course, the sadhana at a level of mind and emotional aspects of our nature. And as we know that the origin of disease or origin of most of diseases in the mind itself. So if we are able to modify our reactions in the day-to-day life, that will go a long way in reducing the miseries of life. So vitarka badhe, vitarka he has given. What is vitarka? Vitarka hinsa daya krutakarita anumodita lobha moha krodha purvaka dudu madhyama adhimatra iti. That means that Himsa Ityadaya. That means that Vitarka means that something opposite of Yamas. There are five Yamas. Ahimsa, Satya, Aste, Aparigraha, Brahmacharya. These are the five Yamas given by Patanjali. The opposite tendencies of Yamas are built into our being because we are evolved from the animals and we have got animal instincts present in us. And animal instincts are nothing but the tendencies of opposite to Yamas. So Himsa is the built-in tendency of our mind. And that's why Patanjali has given so much importance to observance of Yama and Niyama. Because Yama has to be observed consciously. And that's why if your tendencies towards the opposite of Yamas, Himsa, etc., then you have to consciously bring into your mind Pratipaksha Bhavana, opposite tendency. If you have got the basic instinct of Hinsa in your mind, so consciously you have to bring Ahimsa in your mind. Now that is the modification of tendencies of our mind. And that's why Pratipaksha Bhavanam is an important tendency. Even in common terms, those people who become angry very easily. So they are given the advice that when you are angry, count 10 numbers, one up to 10. Why? Because you get time to modify your reaction of the mind. And that's why Patanjali says that you have to modify the reaction of the mind to overcome these vitarkas in our life. And once you are able to overcome these vitarkas, that will go a long way in steadying your mind, in balancing your mind. And once the mind is balanced, you can overcome all those psychosomatic diseases which we experience in day-to-day life. And one more sutra I want to bring to your attention is that he has given the various effects of practice of Yama Niyama. And one of the sutra says that santoshat anuttam sukhalava. When you practice santosha, contentment, then we can get anuttama, we can get high level of pleasure in our life. That means that contentment is the acceptance. Once you train your mind to accept the situation, acceptance doesn't mean that not doing any efforts to improve your condition. Accept is to accept the thing as it is. Accept that there are going to be pleasure and misery in my life, and I'll work on reducing the miseries. But miseries are part and parcel of our life. So if we practice the santosha niyama, then that leads to anuttama sukhalava. So that is also one of the important facets of yoga therapy, which is ignored many times, I believe. So at the end of it, I think I have discussed or I have tried my best to discuss, because I'm not very much well studied person, but I have tried my best to find a scriptural base for using yoga as a therapy. And as we have seen, that prevention of the ailments, the base of that is found in Patanjali Yoga Sutra, Heyam Dukkham Anagatam. That means that by the yoga sadhana, we can prevent the arising of diseases in ourselves. So that is the structural, scriptural, the proof that we can prevent the diseases by the sadhana of yoga. Of course, we are not going to the details of what sadhana we have to do for prevention of diseases, but I have tried my best to establish that yoga sadhana can be used for prevention of diseases.